messed up. Stressed out with no luck. But every time I wake up, I get a chance to wake up. Thank God I got a chance to wake up. Wake up, another day that get my cake up, cake up. Cause every time I wake up, I get a chance to wake up. Wake up, wake up.
Wake up, little slick, get up out of bed. You was like a couple steps away from being out of here. Thank you for my granny prayers. Thank you for my partner now. I thought I was finished, yeah. Jesus told me start again. I will party sundown to day's end. Making money that I can't spend. I had a failing marriage and some fake friends. I had to doubt my doubts and let faith in. Was broken. God done brought me out like I was Moses. I'm chosen. Woke up Sunday morning feeling focused. Funny acting. Swipe left, yeah. That's on mama's, always capping. Swipe left, yeah, no more drama. Boy, you know you blessed. Last night was a mess, God just hit refresh.
I've been messed up, stressed out with no luck. But every time I wake up, I get a chance to wake up. Thank God I got a chance to wake up. Wake up, another day that get my kick up. Cause every time I wake up, I get a chance to wake up. Wake up, wake up.
Wake up in the new Diablo. Father church me like I'm Pablo. Sunday service on the front stoop with a cup of tea in a condo. Tony Evans kicking convo, walking me through my storm. And I ain't grew up hearing gospel, but I got it playing this morning. I done been through this a time or two. I keep going back, but now I'm finally through. I'm like, if I was God, I'd be tired of you. But he be open arms like he desired you. I'm like, wow. Smoking, sipping, slipping, thought I lost my grip. And wow, pulled me back and told me I'm forgiven.
I woke up Sunday morning, weighed up on my chest. Had to remind myself that every day I'm blessed. Cause every time I wake up, I get a chance to wake up. Thank God I got a chance to wake up. Wake up, another day that get my kick up. Kick up. Cause every time I wake up, I get a chance to wake up. Wake up, wake up.
Seasons change the color so quickly, it's hard to keep up with the leaves. Cause everybody leaves. On my birthday, Kobe, Gigi, and Seven Souls remind me that the tree of life is so uncertain. And tomorrow has unpredictabilities as colorful as the smiles that took off that day. May that Sunday morning resonate past trophies and trinkets and the ongoing pursuit of more to sober us with the humbling truth. My life and your life. It's just a vapor. And if what you see is all you see, then you do not see all there is to be seen. Quickly, we leave.
Right, if you children want to follow Mr. Sean out, this is your cue, if you want. Come on, give it up one more time for Devotion in Motion. And those girls, they serve so awesome. Will you hand me that water? I forgot to bring it up with me when I came. So good to see everybody. And we got Christmas coming up in just a few days. We have an Alexa in our dining room part of the house, you know, and it's probably one of the worst things because every morning I get a fresh reminder of when Christmas is because the boys come out every morning. Hey, Alexa, how many days till Christmas? And we ain't went shopping yet, so every time I hear that go off, I'm like, ah! But we're going tomorrow. How's everybody else on their Christmas shopping? Nah. I hear a lot of gift cards are going out this year. That's what I hear, a lot of gift cards, amen. I wear a size 4 hours in gift cards at the tattoo parlor, so anybody who wants to throw that down, nothing. You guys are not talkative this morning. That's not going to work. No, but it's good to be here. And you know, we're entering into this season where so much experience and so much of what we do gets commercialized, doesn't it? And so much of what we see is what we have under the tree. And just as Kurt Franklin there spoke, if all we see is, if all that we see in our presence is all we see, then we do not see all there is to be seen. Amen. And so this morning I come talking about the gift. His name is Jesus Christ, because oftentimes we come into a season like this and media stores want to pump and they want to stay open later so they can make sure that they get the sales to you. And everywhere we go, Christmas is commercialized. Christmas is taken from Jesus Christ and put on the back of Santa Claus. And the person saying, Saint Nick was a great man, but this mythical creature that we've created from Saint Nicholas has turned into this Santa Claus, and we ride so much of this holiday season in on the backs of Santa when this was all brought in through the birth of Jesus Christ. The gift that we were given was the day that Christ was born. He fulfilled the prophecies that were uttered about him some hundreds and thousand years before his birth. Here is Jesus Christ coming as the gift, and still yet sometimes culture seems to try to display that differently in our life, because now you know there's an iPhone 12 and it's got 5G. Anybody? I'm not getting it for a while. Here it scrambles your brain, so I'm going to wait for a minute. I'm going to watch and see what everybody else does. I was reading about a pastor in California who put out a sign during the Christmas season, and it stated, "Jesus is the reason for the season. Merry Christmas." And it seemed that most of the community was super excited about this message as people begin to gather to take selfies around it, and people would honk as they would go by sending it or seeing the message there displayed before the church as we celebrate this Advent season, this season of expectation and the birth of Jesus Christ. But there was one woman who was not excited about what she's seen out there in front of the church. So she wrote, took up her pen and wrote the pastor to let him know that she wanted to complain formally about his message in front of his church. She wrote him stating this: "The church should not try to drag religion into every single holiday." Okay, some of y'all caught it. For a moment, it allows us to laugh and find humor in the situation, but the reality of it is that our society has taken Christmas and allowed this kind of paganism format to flow over it, where whoever has the most gifts and who was the best during the year gets the most amount of gifts, right? And if that's the gauge we were going on, y'all probably know a whole lot of people that are getting cold out for Christmas, right? Right? Just cold, hard, cold. No cash, no gift cards, nothing. Just some cold. Y'all got kids like that? I'm about to just line them up and call them all cold for Christmas, right? Come on, somebody, bear witness with me, right? But the truth of the matter is, once we move past the humor, we realize that Christmas is really about celebrating the greatest gift that was ever given in the form of a man named Jesus, who came down out of his royalty from heaven to be born into a manger, giving himself a great place of humility and humbling himself before man, to be raised by the flesh, be raised by people who were imperfect and fail. Yes, Mary might have been without spot or blemish when God found her to bring about the immaculate birth there, but in her life somewhere she's got to have some type of sin after the birth of Jesus. Somehow, somewhere, Jesus still decided that it was worth it to come down for you and I and be the greatest gift of all, even though he knew that we would be still sinners in the midst of it. The Bible says this in Isaiah 9:6, "For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." You see, Jesus was that child that was born. And as we can see here from Scripture, there are three things that I feel like we can learn from the birth of Jesus Christ. We can learn that there was a promise, there was purity, and there was a plan for your and my life. The gift of Jesus throughout the Old Testament, as the Hebrew people begin to wait for anticipation of this Messiah, it's what we've been celebrating the last 4 weeks, or last 3 weeks rather, on Wednesday night, and this last coming week here, this coming Wednesday, when we'll celebrate love, talking about the anticipation of a notable person who is Jesus Christ, the Advent that we are in. And the Old Testament pushed forward to expect this Messiah, and as the New Testament is written and the disciples begin to follow Jesus, their anticipation is the same. And you and I in 2020 are expecting a soon coming king. Amen. I know I am. I'm waiting on Jesus. I'm watching the signs. I'm seeing not what's going on in just America, but I'm watching the world to see what's happening. And I know that we are in a season of Advent. We are in a season of expectation, just as the Hebrews were early on. The first prophetic utterance comes to us, though, all the way from the Garden of Eden, all the way in the book of Genesis. You may remember this from Sunday school, Genesis chapter 3, 14 through 15. So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. And he will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." In his punishment, God goes on, and you know that women, they begin to have multiplied childbirth pains. And, of course, men are struck into a life of labor. What we take on in us in this first gospel telling here, as God comes in and he begins to speak, we take on that Adamic nature. It's an inherent sin that you and I can never get away from. Adam and Eve learned a painful experience of what it would mean to disobey God in his right. God told them they could have anything but that one thing, and they allowed the serpent to walk in and speak to her. Many blame the woman for talking to the serpent first, but let's face it, the Bible says, and the man who was with her. So there was a team situation at some point, and somehow or another, they still fell to this place of sin, and falling under this sin, God comes in to bring judgment under his righteousness. They chose their course of action, and it was disobedience, and God chose his course of action. Theologically speaking, God can only respond with a way that is consistent with Scripture, and so punishment must come forth. If we're speaking in modern-day terms, we may just say it like this: God cannot let sin go unchecked. On the other hand, we see what's going to happen with Satan as he's entered into a whole nother batch of problems with this prophetic promise that is put over them. Now, for most of us, we're saying, "Pastor, I don't see this promise that you're talking about. So far, the son is getting his heel strike, the serpent's getting his head crushed, the woman's going through more childbirth pains, and the man's got to work. Come on, somebody, I don't know about you, but I'm really going to have a conversation with Adam and Eve for getting me kicked out of the Garden of Eden before I ever got to be to paradise. Can I get a witness?" Nobody? I ain't talking to y'all then today. And here comes Satan, though, and this death sentence is dealt to Satan. God already reveals his plan to defeat Satan and offer salvation to the world. In the middle of this tragedy, there's an offer of hope. There's a flicker of righteousness because God reveals to us a proto-evangelium, and that is the Latin term that simply means this: the first gospel telling that we receive in Scriptures. This is the gospel of salvation through the grace of God, and God is telling us that Jesus will come to be our righteous Savior. 700 years in advance of his birth, the prophet Isaiah delivered this promise from heaven, talking about the gift that would be the birth. "Therefore, the Lord himself will give us a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." The promise, the gift to come is Emmanuel, literally meaning God with us, God in the flesh. Christ's birth would be no ordinary birth. It would be the significance of God coming to dwell in this earth with you and I. The gift that we receive from heaven in this birth is a pure birth. Jesus would be born of a virgin, and obviously that's a supernatural, miraculous birth that just doesn't happen every day, right? You don't just go to the hospital and profess something of that nature. Matthew 1:18, the Bible said, this is how the birth of Jesus came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. The word of God is clear. It's unapologetic on this matter. In the garden, I'm sure that Satan didn't get it in the moment, and I believe that Adam and Eve didn't get it in the moment, and sometimes it's hard for you and I to wrap our minds around this idea of this Emmanuel who's born of a birth that's a virgin birth, but we know, and Mary received that gospel through Gabriel coming down to let her know she would be the one, and shortly coming, she would be the one impregnated with the Holy Spirit. The Bible teaches that the sin nature is handed down through man, and this is important. Watch this. Every person who has entered the world through the old-fashioned way walks in with a sin nature upon them, an inherent sin that we have received from Adam and Eve. But Jesus Christ was born of a pure birth. You see, this didn't happen the normal way. Jesus was not coming down through the bloodline of man, but rather he was coming down through the bloodline of the Father and God through a woman who was born or who was a virgin at this point. And so as the bloodline follows, Jesus inherits this sinless nature over him as he follows through the bloodline of the Holy Spirit. And so one drop of blood from the Savior can bring healing to a stricken soul, as the Bible says. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Amen. Because he wasn't finished with the healing of the sin of the sickness, he also said he will do this. He will comfort all who mourn, and he will provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. Come on, somebody, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. And he also goes on to remind us that all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be born with child. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. And the greatest gift that we can ever receive was a planned gift. God had a plan from the beginning. There was no plan B. There was no, oops, this doesn't work out. There was no, what do I do when Adam and Eve sin? God doesn't even ask that question when you sin. Nothing takes God by surprise. And so for God, there was no plan B in this situation. There was a plan from the beginning. God never scratched his head in heaven, and you have never knocked God off his rocker. No means that he can't figure out the situation in your life. I know some of us get real good mixed up inside our emotions, get mixed up inside of these other things, and we think that we've got God confused and confounded. But let me tell you that God is not sitting back trying to figure out how your situation will unfold. God has no plan B. God has Jesus in our life. Amen. And as we noted earlier, Adam and Eve received that first promise of that planned birth that was coming. In Genesis 3:15, he said, and I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and hers, and he will crush your head and you will strike his heel. He was coming to do battle with the forces of evil. And we are told that he was coming to crush the serpent's head, which is a fatal injury that's going to be offered to him. He came to defeat evil. That was his sole mission. This was the promised one coming to deliver humanity from the sin of which it had fallen into. One that would deal us sure death. But Jesus stepped in and did something different. The Bible says in Revelation 13:7, it says, the Lamb who was slain before the foundation of the world. You see, sometimes we get so confused and we think that God's trying to figure out our situation, and God was trying to figure out the sin in the Garden of Eden, and God's trying to figure out how we messed up. But the Bible says in Revelation 13:7 that the Lamb who was slain from the foundation of the world, that means as the world was beginning to be created, as God spoke and fashioned it and formed it into the world, from eternity's past, Jesus Christ stepped into our present reality, reached back to the cross, paid the price for your sin and through my sin, because God doesn't doesn't have a plan B. God has a plan all the way through time. In the mind of God, Jesus always was, Jesus always is, and Jesus always will be the gift that we receive. Amen. And through that, we receive the salvation of mankind. The idea was God's plan to redeem humanity to himself through the blood of Jesus Christ. That's the gift. The prophet Micah foretold of this plan all the way down to the place of Jesus' birth in Micah 5:2. It said, but you, Bethlehem, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be the ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times. Jesus was indeed born in Bethlehem, just as the prophet would say. In a sense, Jesus was the oldest baby to ever be born. As John would say, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Somebody bear witness. Alan, if you can play some closing music for us. Jesus is God's plan for our life. God's promised and pure plan not only included his Savior named Jesus Christ, but just as I alluded earlier, as he moved through eternity, his plan included you as well. Lieutenant Coffey spent several years as a POW, a prisoner of war during the Vietnam War. During his second Christmas in camp, he came to a very serious realization in his life. He had been stripped of everything by which he measured his identity. His rank, his uniform, his family, his money. Alone in a cramped 3x7-foot cell, he began to understand the significance of Christmas. Removed from all the commercial distractions in this small cell, he was able to focus on the simplicity of the birth of Jesus Christ. Although he was lonely and afraid, he realized that Christmas could be significant and have meaning, because now, more than ever, he understood in this moment that even though he thought he was a mistake, God had a plan. Even though he felt he was a mistake because he was born out of wedlock, God still had a plan. You might believe you have messed up in your life and you have gone too far, but I'm telling you today that God still has a plan for your life. Today, the good news is that Jesus wants to step into your life and be healing for a broken heart. He wants to be freedom in the midst of your captivity. He wants to be provision in the place of your joy. He wants to be your garment of praise and remove your heaviness. This gift is the birth that provides an extraordinary life. And in fact, he says that he wants to come and give us life and give us life abundantly. I've come to tell you today that there was a promise through purity that meant a plan for your life. And today we can stand up knowing that we are redeemed believers of God who has a plan for each and every one of us. That is the gift of Christmas that has been bestowed upon humanity, that Jesus Christ may redeem us unto himself. Would you stand with me all over this room today? If you're able, I just want us to go into a place of prayer this morning, and I want you to go into a place of searching. Things happen. Lieutenant Coffey was somebody who had to have life ripped away from him, spending his second Christmas in a POW camp. And there, he realized that Christmas wasn't about what he was going to receive on earth, but what he received in the supernatural, and that was Jesus. Today, I don't know where you are, but I want to tell you that Jesus Christ can be your personal Lord and Savior. It doesn't matter if you've known Jesus and walked away. It doesn't matter if you were a heavy religious person before, if you considered yourself a spiritual person before, and you've walked away from that. God wants to redeem you today. God still has a plan for your life. Maybe your prayer life isn't where it should be. Maybe I don't know what your maybe is, but maybe you feel like you've fallen away from God today, or you've begun to pull back from the presence of God. Today can be the day that you reestablish with the Lord Jesus his intent all the way from the Garden of Eden. That one day you will walk with him again in eternity. Just as Adam and Eve walked with him in the cool of the day, we will spend eternity in heaven with the Savior.
Right now, he wants to flood you with joy. He wants to flood you with peace, happiness. Jesus, you are worthy. And Lord, we offer our hope to you this morning. Come on, maybe today you don't know Jesus at all, and you're just like, I'm not really even sure. My cousin, I just confessed to you. He came to church, and he was so paranoid about coming to church. We ran together when we were younger, and I got out of the lifestyle a lot sooner than he did. And he was so paranoid about coming here. He just thought that the roof was going to fall in, you know. He was worried that he's going to fall into this ball of condemnation and fire. But when he left, he said, you know, I felt something that was different. I felt received. What he felt was the anointing of the Spirit of the Lord. I want to tell you the day when you begin to open your life to a relationship with Jesus Christ and you begin to feel that condemnation about what if, what about my sin, what about the way I'm dressed, what about my piercings, what about my hair, what about my tattoos, what about my past life, it's jaded. Hey, listen, I want to promise you that no preacher that ever preached, no bishop that ever ruled, no apostle that ever led, no evangelist that ever walked has not come from some sort of jaded past. Believe me, Paul was written up as a murderer. He was killing and persecuting the Christian church, and Jesus still bestowed his grace upon him. I promise you this, that you have never outreached the grace of God, because he is ever reaching, his arm is ever reaching into your life. That just means that he will never stop, he will never give up. Jesus don't have any quit. You've not gone too far to receive the love of Christ. That's condemnation for people, or thoughts putting on you this morning, or thoughts putting on you about bringing your life to Jesus. That's the tricks of the enemy, just as the enemy tried to trick Eve and Adam in the garden. The love of Jesus is the proto-evangelium, which means the first gospel telling, which says, even though I knew you were going to sin, even though I know you're going to mess up, I'm still going to send my son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross for your sins in the midst of your mess, whatever it is. So wipe out of your mind that you've gone too far, or you messed up too bad, or you're too far into a pit. Jesus Christ can redeem you from that place right now. Lord, you are worthy. I'm going to drop back in this place. I just feel this to pray over the church. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. How many know that Jesus came as the light, and he set us as a city upon a hill and placed the light on the inside of us? Come on, that means that Jesus has sent us as the light. He has sent us to proclaim with the same anointing that he put on Jesus in Luke 4:18, when Jesus read that the Spirit of the Lord is upon him, because the anointing is upon him. The anointing is upon you in this room. I want you to begin to pray for healing in this house. Begin to pray it over this house. Begin to pray healing on somebody's marriage right now if you're able. Begin to pray healing over physical ailment and sickness, right? Lord, we just pray right now. Lord, we pray in this house. Lord, we pray for sickness. Lord, we pray for spiritual ailments in this house. Lord, we pray over spiritual ailments in this house. Lord, we pray that those who are spiritually bound and walking in generational curses will have that broke right now. Will lay down the chains of bondage from somebody who has went before them, and they will pick up the cross of Calvary to break the inheritance that is over them. They will walk in chain-breaking freedom right now. Lord, I proclaim it in this house. Lord, I speak healing on marriages and relationships right now in the year of the Lord's favor. God, I speak your anointing on it. Lord, that we proclaim the good news of the gospel message in the marriage right now. Lord, I pray for comfort for all who mourn. Lord, this has been a year of a loss. But Lord, right now We proclaim that you are providing for those who have lost, for those who are grieving in Zion. Lord, that you are bestowing a crown of beauty. Lord, you are taking away the ashes. Lord, you are bringing the joy instead of mourning. Lord, you are releasing that mourning on them. Lord, we know that goodness and gladness and joy comes in the morning. We know that weeping may endure, but the oil of joy is coming, Lord, and mourning is gone. This morning, let your soul be healed in Jesus' name. And there are some people in here that God wants to speak over your life. He wants to give you a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Come on, church family, I want you right now. If you're in a spirit of joy, if you're in a spirit of walking with the Lord in this presence and the salvation of the joy is, I want you to begin to pray right now, because you have a garment of praise. And right now, I want you to lift up your voices and I want you to pray over the spirit of despair. Saints of God, if you've got that garment of praise, start praying right now. Right now, if you feel heavy laden, though, if you feel like you have despair on your life, I want you to lift up your hands and I want you to begin to pray alongside of those who are declaring and decreeing praise, and I want you just to let that despair go. What does hands lifted represent in our life? Hands lifted in our life resembles sacrifice and the fact that we can't control it and we're giving to God right now. Come on. Lord, there are those praying who have a spirit of praise, a garment of praise, and those who have despair, they're lifting it up. Jesus, I proclaim right now that there's a spirit of praise flowing through this house, flowing over this room. Lord, there's a spirit of praise seeping in, just as it was on the day of Pentecost, ushering into this room, declaring and going forth and showering over us. Lord, there are those who are suffering with despair this morning, and their despair is going into the air and being wrapped in the garment of praise. Lord Jesus, you are clothing it with something. God, you are closing it with a shout of joy, a profession of faith, God, love that is only found in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, before you sent your son that anyone who should believe in him would not die, but have eternal life. My God, you are. Oh, you are the God of beauty. Lord, you are the God of joy. Lord, you are my covering. Lord, you are my garment of praise. And I can have each and every one of these because you were the greatest gift ever given. To every soul that has received salvation in here, you have the greatest gift that has ever been given. For every soul in here that just professed Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you have the greatest gift that has ever been given. For those who will proclaim later, you will receive the greatest gift that has ever been given. Did you know that in the Bible says this? It says that in heaven, every time one sinner turns their life over to God, that there is rejoicing in the heavens, that the angels begin to rejoice. Let me tell you something. That means for your old ratchet self, that means for your old sinful self, that means for you still sinning while Christ died for you, that when you finally get saved and inherit that salvation on your life, that the heavens break free in a party and worship. And so, can you imagine? Imagine all of heaven celebrating for you. I'm gonna come over here because that was good. I know that was good. Can you imagine all of heaven? Come on, all of heaven just turned up at your salvation, at the point of your salvation. Okay, some of y'all starting to feel that over here now. My God, come on, that is who you are. If you know it, sing it this morning. Y'all don't sing, I'm going to. My God. That's who you are, Lord. You are the greatest gift we could ever receive, Jesus. Who you are. You're in the outside. Alpha and the Omega. You are the beginning and the end. You are the first and the last. You are all things in between. You are significant in all things in my life, and your grace is sufficient for everything that I will ever endure. Let the church say amen. Amen. Christmas season brings a whole lot of different things this year, doesn't it? Celebrations and stuff will look a whole lot different than they've probably looked in the past. And we're going to be gathering with family that we haven't seen in a while. So what we're going to do at Risen Hope Church is we're going to go live only for the next two services. That'll be over the next two, some everything. Of course, we'll still have youth ministry tonight. But then this will be our last of anything in-house for 2 weeks. And everything else will be virtual. We're doing that because we know you're going to be around family. I know I'm going to be around family. And, you know, I'm going to be around nieces and nephews and aunties and uncles and the whole nine yards. And you're going to be doing the same. And we're going to try our best to social distance. And we're going to try our best to wear masks. And we're going to try our best to do all those great things. But let's face it, hugs will be given. Masks will be off. Right? That stuff's going to happen. And, you know, not living in fear, but we're living in faith. Amen. Before we begin to think this is a fearful, this is a wise decision. I believe there are other churches doing it as well. And I think we play into the wisdom. Corona is real. The media hype on Corona is also real, but there's also a situation to take serious. Amen. We've lost loved ones because of COVID. COVID is very close to many of us in this church. And the last thing we want to do is gather with family and then come into the church. And I'm not saying anybody will get it over the holiday season. I pray that you don't. I pray that everybody's healthy. And then when we come back, you just say, Pastor did that out of overabundance of caution and nobody gets sick. And praise the Lord, right? And we'll all be skippy happy. But January 10th, we'll be back in person. That means over the next couple weeks, you're going to catch us live the last Sunday in December and the first Sunday in January. You'll catch us live here at 11 a.m. Wednesday nights, we'll still be putting our YouTubes out and things of that nature, okay? So the next 2 weeks like that. Tonight, 6 p.m., you want to be here. Also, as you leave today, we have the scene setter arrangement set up out there, and a couple of our youth are going to be out there. Those are $10 each for custom ornaments. You'll get your picture on it. You'll get your picture printed right away if you want that. If you're not able to do it right now or you wanted to bring some other family and friends, we'll be here at 6 tonight for youth service. You could pop in then as well. You also may say, I don't have cash on me. That's the awesome thing. Alan, would you throw our giving up on these screens and leave it up? 937-421-6755. You can go out there, get your picture taken, and then text your offer in, right? Or your donation in. There's a donation thing out there. Of course, you can go on our website and pay as well. So, yeah, thank you, Alan. And he'll leave that up. So as you're going and getting photos, you can check that out. Listen, have a Merry Christmas. Be safe. I cannot wait to see you. Or rather, I can't wait for you to see me over the next 2 weeks, right? So I'm going to say, glad you got to see me today for the next 2 weeks. That's how I'll sign off. And then January 10th, we're going to be right back in this building, right? Sickness-free, corona-free, flu-free, right? Come on, somebody. All right. Amen. I love you. Have a Merry Christmas.